Welcome back to Live from the Heartland. We are up here on the stage as we are every Saturday morning, talking to good folks doing good things in the world and hopefully informing you as well of events and ideas, etc. How you doing, Michael?
Oh, I'm good.
We're welcoming back to the stage a guy who was on this stage doing this show before either of us, and that is Mr. Danny Postal. Hello, Danny.
Hello, Katie.
Welcome back.
Michael, thank you. It's fantastic to be here.
He was one of the first.
It's an honor to have.
One of the first Live from the Heartland hosts up here. And when you hear his voice, you'll understand why. So Danny came this morning unaccompanied by his co-author Nader Hashimi. Hashimi?
Right.
Is that the right word?
Hashimi, yes.
Hashimi. I've been busily trying to finish The Syria Dilemma, this incredible little book that you guys put together, including the writings of some 10, eight.
Actually, about 20.
Is it 20 writers?
MIT Press.
Incredible array of opinions and thoughtful approaches to the problem that is Syria, which now is every day on the radio, on TV. I mean, again, today, this morning before I left, some terrible stories of what's going on. And you really do a service. How did it come about, this book?
Well,
between
thank
the two
for
of
those.
You?
I appreciate that praise, Katie. That was the idea of the book, was to survey and assemble a range of views on Syria, because when the Syria crisis started, Nader Hashimi and I are longtime collaborators. We did a previous book together on Iran, on the Green Movement in Iran, and I think you had us, or you had me on the show about that.
We've had him
many
times.
Well,
this
was,
is,
he
I'm
was
a repeat offender.
With that.
That's right. So Nader and I have been working together for many years, and when the Syria crisis exploded in 2011, he was in Denver. I was here in Chicago working in the labor movement, but we were just bouncing emails back and forth, circulating articles, critiques, analyses, to try to make sense of this horrific event, series of events that were unfolding, the carnage, the tragedy.
Yeah.
And we were trying to map out, you know, the debate. It was so confusing. I mean, who were the different players? Who were the different forces? Which side should we be on? Who are the good guys? Who are the bad guys? Who should we be in solidarity with?
Right.
So complicated, right? So
right.
many different dimensions to it, both within Syria. Then you had the regional geopolitics, if you
sure.
will. You have Iran on the side of the Assad regime. You have Saudi Arabia on the side of the opposition. Then you have the geopolitics of it. You have Russia on the side of Syria. You have the United States, at least rhetorically, on the side of the opposition, if not materially. Very complicated. So Nader and I decided, you know what, we need to organize an international conference on Syria, because just the two of us, we don't have the answers. We're thinking about it, but it's very complicated. Let's get 20 or 30 of the smartest people in the world on Syria. Human rights experts, Middle East scholars, members of the opposition. Let's get people together, lock them in a room for 2 days, and see what they come up with. The book is essentially
what they came
the
up,
product
what you guys came up
of
with.
That conference, although we also included some voices who were not physically present for the conference.
So out of the many chapters in this book, were how much of it, besides your and Nader's part, written just for the book?
Because several,
yeah.
Yeah,
I got that feeling too.
And that was important to us,
yeah.
And it was actually important to our publisher too, because if you just reprint a bunch of stuff that's already out there, people just can grab it off the internet and
right.
they don't need to buy the book. So the publisher was insistent that there be a number of original pieces. One of them is written, I'd like to put a little plug in for it. It's written by a very, very interesting Syrian activist by the name of Afra Jalabi.
Oh, yeah.
Afra's essay is about the nonviolence movement in Syria, which I think has gotten too little attention
always,
in these debates.
Always the nonviolent movement gets too little attention.
Exactly, and especially in a situation like Syria, where the news is carnage, bloodshed, atrocities, mass starvation, total humanitarian crisis, malnutrition, people dying of starvation. So Afra wrote an essay in which she surveys the landscape of nonviolence activists in Syria and talks about their deep soul-searching about why did the movement go from nonviolent to violent, and at what cost? And so Afra, by the way, will be here in Chicago Tuesday night, speaking with me and your close friend Bernadine Dorn at the International House at the University of Chicago at 6 p.m. And I just encourage
at
people...
At 1414 East 59th Street.
Well, thank you very much. I mean, it's a long ways from Rogers Park here, but it's... I think it's a
20 minutes by car.
There you go. It's a unique... you know, Afra is one of the major voices of the Syrian nonviolence movement. She is one of those activists, and that's why her essay in the book, I think, is really one of the special pieces. It was written specifically for the book, cannot be found anywhere else.
Danny, give us a little background of the Syria crisis. What's a little bit of history of it and the current situation? Just a little bit, because we got a lot of questions.
Absolutely, and I'm glad you asked that, because I think, especially with all the bloodshed and the tragedy that we see in Syria every day, we often forget, how did this start? The Syrian uprising started in March of 2011, and remember that it was not isolated. It came out of and was very much part of and inspired by the Arab uprisings in Tunisia, in Egypt, in Bahrain, in Yemen, in Libya, and across the Arab world. If you look at the slogans of the original protesters in Syria, they were the same exact slogans that you had in Tunisia and Egypt. The people want justice, dignity, freedom. There was, in fact, the original incident that essentially triggered the Syrian uprising was some kids, some teenagers, in the city of Dara, who spray painted, they took spray paint and they spray painted on a wall the slogan, "The people want the end of the dictatorship." That was a crime under Assad Syria. This is a one family state party apparatus.
A minority.
For 30 years.
44 years.
44 years.
Okay, 1970. So at that time it was 37 years, or I'm sorry, 41 years of power, of one family rule. Which Human Rights Watch describes the prison system in Syria as a torture archipelago. So these kids spray painted the slogan, "The people want the end of the dictatorship." They were arrested. They were detained. When their parents went to claim them from the jail, their bodies were so badly mutilated from torture that they barely recognized them. And the parents complained about this, and the police said to them, "Don't worry about your kids. If you want more kids, bring your wives here and we'll make some more for you." So this indignity inspired a wave of protests across Syria. Now let's remember, to get back to your question, Mike, the first 7-8 months of the Syrian uprising, from March 2011 to the end of that year, were totally nonviolent. There were no jihadis, there was no violence. The slogans of the revolution were democratic, they were emancipatory. Then, after the wave of repression, the Assad regime responded to these nonviolent protests with an absolute paroxysm of violence.
Yeah.
Open fire, live ammunition on peaceful demonstrators, sniper attacks, people being shot in the face, children being killed. So this inspired more and more and more protests, but after 7, 8, 9 months of it, some of the Syrian activists decided, we cannot take this laying down anymore. They took up arms, and then, of course, we have the bloody civil war, which is at a stalemate, now on its fourth year. We are at the fourth year point of this horrific conflict.
And millions of refugees.
Refugees, chemical weapons.
Well,
sectarian hatred. I mean, we got a lot of issues.
Many people are displaced out of the country.
Millions.
Yeah.
Approximately one-third of Syria's population has either been displaced internally or has been forced into refugee status outside the country. Of course, this has a destabilizing effect on the whole region.
Exactly.
Across the Turkish border, the Lebanese border, the fifth largest city in Jordan right now is a Syrian refugee camp called Al-Zaatari. A refugee camp is the fifth largest city in Jordan. The destabilization of the region is actually one of the many horrific consequences of this conflict.
What's going on in Aleppo right now?
Well, in Aleppo, Aleppo is Syria's largest city. It's a historic city. In fact, UNICEF has declared much of Aleppo a world cultural treasure, a world culture
Doesn't
site.
Doesn't look that way on the TV
well,
these days.
Well, now it's in ruins. And so what you have is the Assad regime is dropping barrel bombs. Barrel bombs, for those unfamiliar with this particular invention, it's these massive barrels, oil drums, filled with nails and other very, very sharp...
A lot of old-style primitive...
It's, well, this is the interesting thing. For all of the talk of chemical weapons back in the late summer, early fall, chemical weapons have killed less than 2% of those who have died in this conflict. Most of the death and destruction in the Syrian war has been caused by very old-fashioned, straight-up gunfire, artillery, aerial attacks, bombardments. These barrel bombs are truly horrific. And so in Aleppo right now, you have a massive destruction. Just the other day, a building was bombed with this these barrel bombs. Most of those dead were children and older ladies and men. I'll also mention another one of the most horrific things happening in Syria right now is what is the activists are calling starvation sieges. Somewhere between 300 and 600,000 Syrian civilians, and I want to emphasize civilians here, because you might say, well, I don't like the rebels. I don't know which side I'm on. Just think about this. Civilians, not armed actors in this conflict, are currently besieged in these areas around some of the major cities of Syria. They're starving to death, literally. Some of them have died of starvation. Many of them are malnourished. You can see the pictures online, babies. You can see their rib cages. Now, the question is, why are they starving? It's not a famine. There's a lot of food in Syria, 15, 10 miles from these besieged areas, but food can't get in. Armed actors, mostly Assad regime forces, but also some militias, are surrounding these towns. People can't get out to get food. Humanitarian aid workers can't get in with food and medicine. Doctors can't get in. So you have a crisis where people are starving to death, and there's food right there a few miles away.
What I found was interesting, just, I'm sorry, Michael.
I'm sorry,
Was the conversation in between all the articles in here about the history since Bosnia of humanitarian intervention versus military actions?
Right.
And which, of course, is the conversation being had in the White House, I'm sure, right now, in the State Department, in England, all over the place, all over the place.
Right.
We out here had a candlelight vigil. Back in the fall, was that, or summer?
Well, it was when Obama was talking about Syria had to come, make them
the
move.
Red line.
That was early September.
Yeah,
September.
And then we actually had a woman here from Syria who was defending the Assad regime. And
another guy who was not.
Yeah.
In the same crowd, and peace was had.
Good.
We all felt like, when we went home that night and got the news, it just so happened that night that the news was that, however it happened, Kerry speaking out of turn or whatever craziness.
The pinprick comment.
Exactly. That there was, in fact, not going to be a bombardment of Syria right then by us.
Yes.
Which takes us to the geopolitical.
Exactly.
Right. And Russia and the U.S.
So, but it's what's tricky is we don't want to bomb people anymore. And this book does talk about the wastefulness of the Iraq intervention.
Oh, absolutely.
The incredible waste.
The shadow of Iraq. It looms very large in the Syria equation.
Exactly. So, but what are we to do is what you wind up with. Again,
that's right.
Again, at the end of this book as well.
To quote a famous historical figure of the 20th century, what is to be done? That's the question that the book is about. And the book is titled The Syria Dilemma because there's no clear-cut answer.
In your introduction, you talk about conservative view on this stuff, liberal view, and the leftist view.
Right.
And in every camp, there are people who want intervention or people who don't want intervention.
Exactly. The ideological fault lines of the Syria debate are very complicated. They don't fall along conventional categories.
And be an opportunity.
What I think at the end, Russia, according to your introduction, is less concerned with what goes on locally and is the global picture of who decides. The U.S.
That's right.
Makes a lot of decisions about what should happen in the world, like we're the good guys. And then all of a sudden you have, China and Russia opposed to us. And while we may think that we're better than them in some ways, they may think they're better than us, clearly there's a battle going on between these those three superpowers.
Absolutely.
Two on one side and one on another.
That's right. China is less involved. Russia is much more directly involved. China just generally is not interested in seeing powerful states intervene in the internal politics of other countries. They want to sort of they play this balancing game, whereas Russia has a very direct stake in the Syrian Assad family has been very close to Moscow for a long time.
Maybe the next 2 weeks of Olympics might be a great opportunity for U.S. and allies to step up and have some conversations.
Well, here's where I fall on that question. I think that there's clearly no geopolitical consensus on how to solve the big picture Syrian conflict. There's just not going to be an intervention either one way or the other. That debate has been had. I think Obama, frankly, blew it by hitching his argument about Syria to the chemical weapons issue, A, because that was not the issue. As I mentioned, very few Syrians have died from chemical weapons. That was not the issue.
That's the fact I'm taking away from this.
And secondly, it was a very weak case. Look at how easily Russia short-circuited the whole case. They said, okay, you want to make it about chemical weapons? We've got the answer.
Right.
They were the deus ex machina. They came in and saved Assad's back end. Assad loved that. It was actually perfect. Assad, all of a sudden, who had been claiming he didn't have chemical weapons, he said, oh, those chemical weapons I don't have. Here, you can have them all. So I don't think chemical weapons was the issue. I think the real issue is the humanitarian crisis. And that's what I want to focus on.
Yeah.
I want to look at, and Mary Kaldor has an essay in the book. One of my favorite essays in the book where she says, let's get away from the debate about toppling Assad, arming the rebels, you know, which faction to side with. Let's look at the humanitarian crisis and devise a strategy to protect civilians. And that, to me, these starvation sieges I was describing, how do you get food into these starving areas? Right now, every major organization in the world, Human Rights Watch, the International Crisis Group, they're all calling for humanitarian access to get food to these starving people. But
yeah,
the Assad regime is intransigent. They won't let the aid in. Russia tends to block these UN resolutions saying you have to let aid in. So what happens then? Should Syrian civilians starve to death because Russia and the Syrian government say we're not letting that happen? To me, this really raises some profound questions. I personally would be in favor of an international force, international, not U.S. unilateral
right.
force, an international force.
Like UN?
Ideally.
Okay.
That would say, we are going to use force for one reason only.
To
one
feed
purpose,
people.
To get these humanitarian convoys in so that people don't starve to death. And anyone, any side, not just the Assad regime, any militia, any rebel force, any armed actor who stops these humanitarian convoys from getting through, there will be force used. Now, I personally think Assad would back off at that point.
Isn't there a three-day truce or something going on where there are some convoys going into Aleppo with food?
Homs. That's
okay,
one
Homs.
City, and that's a very good development. I'm glad you mentioned that. But that's, just to be clear, that's 2,500 people involved where they're allowed to get out. And that's a good thing for those 2,500 people and their families. But
there
that's
are thousands
that's a
in Aleppo.
There's thousands in Aleppo, and then there's millions in Syria. We're talking about hundreds of thousands of starving civilians right now across Syria are dying by the day, every day.
You know, one of the things that comes up all the time is Al-Qaeda and various Al-Qaeda-affiliated groups. And I guess Al-Qaeda even said that they were no longer affiliated with one of the groups. What
right.
do you know about what's going on with the role of Al-Qaeda? And while
and are you asking in general about terrorism?
Well, I'm just asking about in the battle. I mean, you have people choosing different sides
yeah.
and different countries
right.
sending people in, et cetera.
Exactly.
What's going on with Al-Qaeda and what kind of role do they really play?
Right. So, I mean, to go back to the origins of the conflict, which we talked about earlier, there was no Al-Qaeda involved. In the first 9 months of the uprising, again, it was non-Islamist, non-violent, democratic, and very pluralistic. By the way, this was not a sectarian conflict at that point. There were Christians, there were even Alawites, there were atheists, there were Marxists, there were all sorts of people involved. It was a cross-section of Syrian society. Then what you had sadly, tragically, was the sectarianization of the conflict, partly because Assad's narrative...
Opportunistic.
It was totally opportunistic. Yeah. And that, by the way, is exactly how al-Qaeda gets involved in all of these conflicts.
Exactly.
They see a vacuum.
Yeah.
They see... situation,
weakness,
a failed state, a collapsing, you know, a calamity. So you just look at the history of this kind of activity, going back to Afghanistan during the Soviet occupation, and then moving on to Chechnya, Bosnia, Iraq. Now
Libya.
It's in Syria, Libya. Now it's in Syria. This is what those folks do. It's an transnational jihadi network. Where do we go next?
Another good thing about this book is the minutiae that you allow people. About those different groups, about the roadways into and out of, not so much out of, but into the quagmire that exists now.
Right.
And it's pretty illustrative of the whole area. And also it does focus a little bit of our attention on what we have done since the Arab Springs began.
That's right.
Including our Libya action, et cetera. And the other thing I liked was the comparison, which didn't hold up, between Bosnia and now.
That's a very good point.
Because the world is a different place than when Bosnia was...
We have two essays in the book on Bosnia.
Yeah, and that was very interesting.
And one of the things that's interesting about the Bosnia pieces is that they both draw these connections between Bosnia and Iraq, but they arrive at different conclusions.
Exactly.
One of the... Ignatieff argues that Bosnia is an example of how humanitarian intervention can work, and so we should apply that to Syria. And the other Bosnia essay says, wait a minute, no. It's all about a political negotiation and a settlement.
Yeah.
So it's Bosnia clearly looms larger, but it's not clear what exactly the lessons of Bosnia are for Syria. It's
you
very
know,
complicated.
You can't help yourself. You're an intellectual, aren't you, Danny?
I've been accused of it.
He's a good guy.
You are.
He used to host the Life from the Heartland show.
He did that.
Well, now, let me ask you this, Danny. You use this term R2P.
Yes.
Responsibility to protect.
Yeah. Right.
And it seems that the world community is not necessarily into that as much as they were back in the Bosnia days.
That's right.
What was the source of R2P? What was the source?
The doctrine, responsibility to protect, was a United Nations inquiry that said, look, we've got these nightmares in the world. You had Somalia. You had Rwanda. You had Bosnia.
Haiti.
You have situations where there are mass atrocities. There are genocides. What do you do? Should a fascist dictator or a mass murderer have the sovereign right to murder
his people,
his own people?
Wow.
And the responsibility to protect commission that the United Nations created came up with this idea that there are values that trump national sovereignty.
Right.
Now, there are only a few cases. It's actually a lot of people misconstrue R2P as basically a blank check for the United States to invade any country it wants. That is not the idea. That is not the idea of R2P. That is actually an abuse of the concept.
Yeah.
Now, I'm not saying I completely sign on to R2P, but let's just be clear about what it is and what it isn't.
Sure.
R2P is highly, highly circumscribed. It only applies to extreme cases, and intervention is only a last resort when everything else fails. Now, we talk about how Syria might actually bring us back in a way, like you were suggesting, Mike. R2P basically is this concept that time forgot. It seemed to be relegated to the dustbin of history after Iraq. I mean, in the case of Iraq, what you had...
Which was not an intervention.
It was not a humanitarian intervention.
No.
The case for intervention in Iraq had to be manufactured, sold with lies.
Sold with lies, and poorly at that.
And then, of course, the actual invasion and occupation were a total catastrophe, human wreckage. And so a lot of people around the world said, oh, man, all this humanitarian intervention and human rights, forget about it. We need to get back to a more realist view of the world. Now Syria, the argument we make in the book is, Syria in some ways almost brings us back to some of those debates about responsibility to protect, but you can't just pretend that Iraq didn't happen. Iraq, the shadow of Iraq looms very large here. I would argue that actually the reason, what you were talking about, Katie, with the vigil you guys held, the reason the American public rejected any intervention in Syria has everything to do with Iraq.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. And Afghanistan.
I think it's tragic in many ways. I think that Iraq is a war that never should have happened. It was based on lies. It was manufactured for nefarious with a nefarious agenda. Syria is a case where it's not clear exactly what is to be done, but something has to be done, because the status quo is just going to lead to more death. The worst is actually yet to come.
God. All right. You know, we run out of time, but I really enjoyed the show. I want to say that this book, The Syria Dilemma, by Danny Postal and Nader Hashimi, is great. And it's available in the store, at the Heartland General Store here.
Maybe Danny will send you a copy.
And we want to thank you so much for coming on.
Thank you,
there's snow falling.
Another announcement that we have a fair tax event here Monday night, the 10th.
Right.
IVI IPO is putting it on. Ralph Martiri, who knows his stuff. We need a progressive income tax in Illinois. So everybody turn out on Monday night. I also want to give a shout out to David Schweikert, the great Marxist sociologist, who is in the crowd. And
my former professor, by
Placente.
The way.
Placente. All right.
We encourage you all to do good in the world, because the world needs all the good that you do. We are going to be back next week with Flint Taylor, who's going to talk about the Vinseco trial. And the week after that, we got Mark Brown coming on to talk about all kind of journalistic things. So,
all power to the people.
Over and out. Have a wonderful day, a wonderful weekend.